I'm going to go on now then to our next presentation and panel. So I'm going to ask our presenter and panelists to join me up here. Donc, Martin Caméré de l'Université d'Ottawa, please come on up. And the four panelists as well, Leisha Strachan from the University of Manitoba, Peter Nedry from the Coaching Association of Canada, and Stephanie Talsma from Physical and Health Education Canada, as well as François Trudeau de l'Université de Trois-Rivières. So please come on up and a warm welcome to our presenter and panelists. Over to you.
All right. Thanks, everyone, for being here. So I know my title is very wordy, but I just kept the same thing that I have in the SHRC and Sport Canada grant. Basically, I'll be talking about teacher coaches and some of the challenges and benefits that they see from coaching in the school system. Before I start, definitely want to thank SHRC. I want to thank Sport Canada. I want to thank everyone at CERC also, and all the volunteers from Algonquin College. It's great that we can get to do this every year, particularly fun for us that are living in Ottawa. It's really easy for us to make it here every year. That's why we make it out, just crossing the bridge, easy for us to come here. But so I'll start off. I only have 15 minutes, but before I get into the nitty-gritty of the research, I just want to make sure everyone understands what a teacher coach is. And so the project that I did is based within the school system. So the teacher coach is a teacher that's teaching full-time, that's their profession, that would volunteer their time to coach sports teams, after-school teams. And so this is the population that I worked with. And so quickly going to go into the research. The project that we ran was a two-phase project. So we started off doing an exploratory qualitative study, and then we followed that with a survey study. So what I did, I was a new professor at that time. I hopped into a car and I traveled across Ontario conducting interviews with teacher coaches in different areas. So I did about 12 interviews with coaches in the area over here, went over to the GTA, interviewed 8 coaches over there, and then make the trek all the way up to Northern Ontario and interviewed 5 coaches over there. So we got a good representation of people from urban as well as rural areas, different type of schools, and so we were able to recruit 25 teacher coaches in total. So the first paper, some of the major themes that emerged from the interviews with these teacher coaches, what this aspect of relationship building. So the teacher coaches would tell us, well, developing relationships as a teacher with the student is not always easy, but a lot of them were explaining that when I put on my coaching hat and the students put on their athlete hat, it makes it a lot easier for us to develop relationships. And so we focused one of our papers on that theme. So I was just going to give you a bit of a few quotes related to what these teacher coaches were saying. And one of the main aspects related to why it was easier to build relationships within the sport environment was this intrinsic motivation for sport. And so one teacher coach would say, well, I have to be in class. It's my job. I have to teach. And kids need to be in class. They need to get credits to graduate. But we want to be in sport. Kids don't have to play sport. They want to play sport. I don't need to coach. I want to coach. So that intrinsic motivation aspect, wanting to be there, facilitated everyone into creating stronger relationships. And interestingly, what a lot of the teacher coaches said is it's really tough. There's a lot of challenges. We're investing significant amount of time, not getting paid to coach. But they said there's a great reward that comes out of it. And so this quote is coming from a football coach. And it was interesting. He's teaching computer science. And so he's in his class with his students. All of a sudden, there's like 6, 7 of his football players come in, start disrupting the whole class. They've got shoulder pads. They've got a cake. And they put on the shoulder pads on the coach, and they start to sing him happy birthday. And then, so when we were having this conversation during interview, he said, no, I couldn't believe that I was having that much of an impact, that they really felt that we were close. Like, as he says in the quote, these are the most testosterone guys in the school, these big macho football players. But they really took time to think about, yes, this is coach's birthday. Let's do something special for him. And so in terms of increasing his job satisfaction, that was a key moment for him. Unfortunately, things are not always rosy. And so this other coach gave an example where he was called in by Children's Aid Society. And one of his athletes on his football team had attempted suicide. And he said, well, we took him in. And the only thing this kid was talking about is you, is coach, coach, coach all the time. And so he said, it's unbelievable. I knew this kid. We were sort of close, but I didn't understand that I had so much impact on his development, and that I was, you know, what he considered to be a role model. And then ultimately, what a lot of the coaches discussed was that being involved with these kids over a prolonged period of time led some to become parental figures. It was more than being a coach. And so another football coach said, you know, he was coaching in a tough area, and he would say, you wouldn't believe how many kids it slipped, and they called me dad by accident. So a lot of these kids didn't have a father figure at home, and the coach implicitly became that parental figure. And so sport has much potential. Sport is very powerful, and that's why we're here. But within the context of school and these teachers just volunteering their time to keep these kids occupied in after-school sport, what we're seeing is it's doing a lot more than that. It's creating a situation where a lot of very close relationships can be developed. However, it's not all rosy. These coaches did talk about a lot of challenges that they face. So we wrote a paper on that. I'll give you a few highlights. This basketball coach said, I was teaching or coaching basketball for both boys and girls. And he said, so I was teaching one group in the morning, I was teaching the other group after school. And so we're, you know, the days are becoming darker and darker as we know it in the fall. And he said, in November, I always got sick. I would get into school, it'd be dark. I would leave school at night, it'd be dark again. And it just took a toll on my health, my psychological health and my physical health. And so these people that are coaching are passionate, but it is taking a toll on themselves in different dimensions. And interestingly, we had a lot of, I would call, more experienced coaches that would always talk to the old days. In the old days, I just got the kids on the bus and we went to tournaments and it was so easy. And then I could sense the frustration in their voices and some of the words they use. So in this quote here, he says, now with all this liability stuff, you know, it's just stupid red tape bullshit. And, you know, getting these papers signed, these huge documents, getting them signed by superintendents. And so they're saying, I coach because I like to be with the kids, but I find myself spending more time in my office filling out all this paperwork, and it's taking away from the fun, the satisfaction that I get from coaching. And so a lot of interesting data came out of that, and we decided to work with School Sport Canada, the governing body for school sport in our country, and we ran a national survey to really understand what is the working status of high school coaches. So we wrote a paper that was published a couple months ago where we really examined what is it to be a high school coach, and so again, what are some of the benefits but the challenges that are faced also. So we were able to get a nationally representative sample. We've got people from every province and territory. You'll see the end. We were able to recruit over 3,000 teacher coaches from across the country. 2-to-1 split for males and females. And we had people that were just starting off their careers up to people that were close to retirement. So here are a few highlights of what we found. We asked them blatantly, because you coach, because you invest significant amount of time in coaching, does your school reward you in any way in terms of a reduce in teaching load or in supervision responsibilities? And it was pretty clear. 97% of our sample said, I get nothing. Everything I do related to coaching is just an add-on to my day-to-day teaching responsibilities. And from some, I don't think I'll be presenting this data, but on average, across these 3,000 coaches, they were spending about 15 to 16 hours a week coaching over the course of the season. So it is a significant add-on to their responsibilities, but they're not getting relieved in any way for it. And then we asked them, well, why are you coaching? What are some of the main benefits that you get from it? And again, it went back to our qualitative data. And so we were able to substantiate that, where they do it because they can get closer to the kids. They can spend more time with the kids, develop better relationships with them, and ultimately have more of an influence on their development. And so that was some of the benefits. The bigger ones were related to that social aspect that comes out of coaching. And then we asked them, well, what are some of the challenges that you face? And we thought we were going to get different ideas here. But ultimately, the top three that were talked about by 90% of our sample that were also discussed as being the greatest extent of a challenge were meeting family obligations, managing their time, and again, that aspect that I talked about earlier, the administrative duties. And so for something to be called a challenge by 90% of the coaches, and again, we had 3,000 coaches, it's something that as a sporting nation, we need to consider. We've got 750,000 kids involved in school sport in Canada, and we've got 52,000 people that are volunteering to coach these kids. And if they have time difficulties managing their family responsibilities, their administrative duties, we're seeing that they're stretched out. And so that's the sense that we're getting from the data. And we asked them, well, what can we do to help you out? And this was somewhat surprising for us because we thought all the recommendations would be more aligned with helping them manage their time and having more time. But the top three in terms of extent were all related to coach education. So I want to feel more efficacious as a coach. I want my school to recognize coach education. I want coach education to be free. And so, again, based on that, for some of you that came to my poster, some of these findings here is what propelled us or motivated us to do the next grant that we're doing, which is focused on coach education related to life skills. So we also ran another study. We had a lot of data, and what we found in our sample is when we did a split, about 40% of our sample was physical education teachers. But 60% were people that were teaching something else. They were coming from all different teaching areas. So we did a comparison of people that are teacher coaches that are phys ed teachers to those that are not to see if any differences came out. So what we found, and some of the major differences, again, related to coaching efficacy. And so when we looked at people when we looked at our two different groups, we saw significant differences. So if you're a PE teacher, they felt more efficacious in their coaching than non-PE teachers. For those that are not trained, the difference was even higher. So if you are a PE teacher, you were significantly more efficacious in your coaching compared to those that were not trained. And then what we found for our PE teacher group, whether you were coach trained through coach education or not, didn't really impact your coaching efficacy at all. And the hypothesis we have is if you're coming in with a phys ed degree, that's probably where you're getting most of your efficacy related to sport-related matters and maybe less related to specific coach education. However, for those that are not a PE teacher, that coach education piece really played a big role in enhancing their self-efficacy for coaching. And the last study that we conducted, that piece on teacher satisfaction was interesting to us. So again, my football coach with the helmet and the football pads. So we wanted to look at this aspect of teacher coach satisfaction a bit more. So we looked at our data and we modeled. And so we look at some of the barriers to sport within the sport environment. So we look at relationships. We looked at the different opportunities that are afforded to coaches through coaching and the athlete relationships. And so there's a lot of things going on in the model, but if I can simplify it, is what we saw is that there were relationships that led to workload-related stress and athlete-related stress. And what we saw is if those that were given opportunities or that they perceived opportunities through coaching, that enhanced their coaching efficacy. And if we look at our outcome variable, teacher job satisfaction, workload-related stressors and athlete-related stressors negatively explain teacher job satisfaction. But if our coaches were more efficacious, that explained teacher job satisfaction. So what does this mean? So I'll try to give some take-home messages. What we're seeing is for high school teachers, coaching sports benefits relationship development with students. We saw this qualitatively and we saw this quantitatively. You get more time with the kids and you can develop better relationships with them. What we saw also within our data is that teachers feel more efficacious coaching when they're properly trained, and that's especially true for teachers that don't have a PE background. Now, if you're coming in from history, you're a history major or a geography major, and you've never played sport, but you're asked by your school to coach sport, what we're seeing is if you can gain some sort of certification, some sort of training, that will dramatically enhance your efficacy for coaching. There's a lot of challenges, and so for high school teachers, coaching sport, taking on that extra responsibility, creates a lot of new challenges to manage related to things that are going on at home, so family obligations, just managing their time, and everything else that's related to that. And then finally, now despite these challenges, and that's what's interesting, that's what we saw, these coaches are going through a lot of challenges. They still want to coach. They're still involved in coaching. They stick around, even though it's getting more and more difficult, because they're getting satisfaction from it. And so what we're seeing is a lot less coaches are doing a lot more coaching. They're coaching two, three, four teams a year. Even though they're facing these massive challenges, they're still sticking around and doing it. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks, Martin, for your presentation. Although I'm representing the academic voice sort of on this panel, this research took me back to my roots as a physical educator. Before I went to grad school, I taught phys ed for 3 years in Winnipeg, and it allowed me to reflect on my experiences of coaching in the middle years particularly. And this is really important work that Martin has and his colleagues have done for the growth of the profession. And not only does it raise questions about youth development, but also raises some important questions about workload and compensation for teacher coaches. In working with our physical education students at the University of Manitoba and other non-PE students who are involved in sport, they'll often use the fact that they can coach or can be involved in coaching as a perk to becoming a new hire in a school. So they often use that as a benefit to hiring and when they go into be interviewed for different positions. And that expectation is set from the beginning, and I know it's really difficult to separate, I think, for new teachers, the responsibilities and the stresses that can be involved in taking a position such as this. This research highlights the tensions and positives of this relationship, but can also give some younger teachers some more insight into some considerations that need to be taken into account if you want to be a teacher coach. My background particularly is more in positive youth development, and previous research in the field highlight the importance and growth and development of Cs of positive development, so namely competence, confidence, connection, character, and caring. And similar to Maktam, in looking at positive youth development through sport, although this research doesn't ask specifically about PYD experiences of youth directly, it seems that at least one of the Cs, particularly connection, is developing in a positive way. So my own research has highlighted, particularly with high-performance coaches, we have found that those who are more successful or high-performance coaches who are more successful in terms of youth development do a really great job of using their soft skills as well as their technical skills. So positive interactions were also more important in those teacher coaches, and that speaks to the ability to use those soft skills such as communication, empathy, understanding in a positive way. And then last year, I was able to do a presentation here on Project SCORE, which is an online resource for coaches to help them deliberately teach the Cs. And one of those Cs as well, connection, has become a really important part of that platform as well. So I just had a couple quick questions, and you can speak to them later if you'd like. But as I was reading it, what caught my eye, again, is this idea of connection. And if there is anything specific that teacher coaches do deliberately to facilitate, the connection that they have with students, and what is it deliberately that they do, and how is that developed and taught? And we saw in Martin's poster that there's a program that they've developed based on these research. Based on the research he's done, and I think it's a fantastic workshop. And I'm curious as to just know how it's different from maybe other standard courses. I know, again, in terms of education and teacher education, which or coach education, which seems to be really important for them, that NTCP does, I think, include some information on how to teach in a positive way to young people. So how's this maybe different, what you're teaching in your program? And then I just had a question in terms of the population, and that seemed like there were quite a bit of male coaches in the population, and just a hypothesis as to how the study might be different if there were more female teacher coaches in the population.
It's not coming on. Oh, here it is. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Camaray, as well. And similar to Alicia, I work for the Coaching Association of Canada right now, but this research hits home for me because I was a teacher coach for 10 years before being a national team coach with Canucai Canada. So, I mean, I want to thank you for this research because I think it's really important, you know, because just, you know, just to add on to that, you know, from an NSO and CAC perspective, but just a Canadian sports system perspective, high school sport, and by extension the teachers, we play a key and crucial role in the whole Canadian sports system, in my mind. They're part of the sports system, and there's a clear link and seamless link to me with our entire sports system as a whole. This includes both from, I know there's OTP in the room here, but also the Sport for Life people, but all the other organizations that are here. It's not just from, it's from a positive youth development perspective that Martin talks about, but also just our athlete pathways. So, you know, there's so many athletes that get their first start in school sport, either because there's no clubs around or parents they can't afford the clubs, or they just choose from a time perspective not to go there. So we don't have to go far from this year at the Olympics to see, you know, Erica Weeb and Natasha Watcham-Roy from here, from this area, that were medalists at the Olympics, and their first experience in wrestling or rugby was from a drama teacher at Philemon Wright. So you were talking about non-phys ed coaches, and then we can talk about Andre DeGrasse as well, who his first track meet was, this high school teacher said, come out and run track, and he ran in basketball shoes, as we all know the story. So that being said, I mean, you know, it's the teacher coaches that get them introduced to quite often to the sports. And just from a participation perspective, we need more athletes doing this. So, I mean, I think, Dr. Camaray talks about those life skills outside of the classroom and what sport brings. So it's really important. I think we have to foster this and make sure that we have a responsibility to help develop our teacher coaches a little better where we can. So just that being said, you know, at the Coaching Association of Canada, this research kind of goes along two themes that we're looking at right now, which is around sustainability, which is one of our pillars, is sustainable education, but also simplicity and how do we make education more accessible. So, you know, I think we have to consider that teacher coaching is a vocation, it's vocational work, and teacher coaches are part of that volunteer base of coaches who go out of their way to provide important programs. So, and they live in a volunteer system. So I think a lot of the similarities that we're seeing with challenges and benefits are really similar. One of the things I was surprised at was the benefits that they saw more revolved around the cool factor of being around the school. You did mention around the intrinsic motivation, but that was something that really surprised me. But, you know, I think, as you said, despite the challenges, they're going to continue to coach because they love it so much. So we just need to find ways on how we impact that and how we provide more services. So some key points that resonated for me around this coaching self-efficacy with the non-phys ed teachers. It's self-reported, but regardless, I think it's really key that they felt way more competent, or they felt more competent as a coach after taking NCCP, which is important for us to know, absolutely. So how do we impact those coaches? And we need to foster this, and I think you know, collectively, we need to be proactive in this area, and how do we impact that? Because the second was the link to job satisfaction as well, which is huge because they feel a lot, they feel that link to job satisfaction. And the third is their recommendations around how do they, how can they get some benefits, or how do they make it more accessible through either some subsidies or PD days and whatnot. So it's important information for us to know when we sit at the table with other NSOs, PSOs, or we sit with other policymakers, education policymakers, and, you know, how do we impact this? Because they are, it's an important role that they're playing. So lastly, just some questions that I would raise is, like, how do we transfer some of these ideas into action? I know you already have your workshop that you've developed, and I too, I'm curious, I haven't seen it yet because I just started at the CAC, but I'm curious to see how that would differ from some of our NCCP and how we work together. But so are we ready with all the stakeholders to kind of integrate some of these ideas? Because, you know, it's important. And then how do we engage better with teacher coaches to better prepare them as well for this type of work? So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Martin. I'm here representing Physical and Health Education Canada. So our vision is that all children in Canada are living healthy, physically active lives. PG Canada does strive to achieve our mission by supporting schools and jurisdictions to become more comprehensive in their approach to school health. So by advocating for and supporting the advancement of quality physical and health education programs, we do believe that students will be equipped to develop the knowledge and skills and attitudes needed to lead those physically active and healthy lives now and into their future. So I'm up here talking about this as a previous teacher coach myself as well, but also on the education side, working in physical and health education now. And toward the policy, on the policy side of it, in terms of school and what teachers are obligated and responsible for in that school space, and what is also beneficial to them. So the research that you're discussing here absolutely has to do with Physical and Health Education Canada. Our membership, our teachers, and the majority of our membership are coaches as well. Those people being discussed in the research, and their well-being is very important to us. Their value and expertise and their positive impact is clear to us. Their commitment to supporting their students and student athletes is something we have the benefit of witnessing each and every day. Any research that gives us greater insight into these benefits or challenges they experience is highly welcome and valuable to us. Two policy positions taken by PHE Canada are relevant to this discussion. We advocate for physical and health education to be taught by qualified specialist physical and health education teachers. We do not believe that physical and health education should be taught by generalist teachers. This research implicitly supports this by acknowledging that PE teachers are more effective as coaches than teachers who aren't trained in PE. The same reason we want them in physical education and health classrooms is the same reason sport would want them coaching in the school sports setting. They are a hot commodity, they're great teachers, and they make great coaches because of their educational training, their interest and passion for sport, and their ability to maximize participation in an inclusive environment. I believe everyone here agrees with this, and there would be no conflict between this advocacy position and the research findings. PHE Canada's second relevant policy point is that we advocate that students should have access to quality daily physical and health education taught by those qualified specialist teachers. Quality daily physical education supports the long-term athlete development model, where all children learn the fundamentals with the goal toward lifelong physical activity participation, whether it be through recreation, leisure pursuits, or competitive movement activities such as sport. Again, no conflict here, and it's not until we turn the discussion towards the allocation of resources. This is where the issue can become contentious. Physical and health education is receiving less and less time allocated to it in the timetable. Manitoba is currently the only province in our country that has mandatory daily physical and health education for all children, grades K to 12. Fewer specialists are in the classrooms. Physical and health education is taught more and more often by teachers not qualified to teach in this very unique environment. PHE Canada believes the number one priority for teachers is the delivery of quality physical and health education curriculum. So because we do have the ability to connect to 100% of the student body, If implemented as intended, our membership has the potential to impact issues such as chronic inactivity, obesity, type 2 diabetes, heart disease. We have the potential to impact attitudes and behaviors surrounding screen addiction, improve academic performance, and impact positive social skill development and character development to develop leadership and cooperation, and to pique their interest in sport participation. All of this in addition to children and youth developing the confidence and competence to lead healthy, active lives. And a lot of these same benefits that physical education teachers do in the classroom, I recognize that coaches also do when coaching sport teams. So all students, not only those who have the opportunity to be involved in school sport, we have only 10 years with our future citizens, and all students, not just the select few who make the cut on sporting teams, but we do have access to all of them in phys ed. So I would be opposed to reducing the time specialist teachers are in the classroom, whether it be for training NCCP or prep time, to make up for the time that they're spent outside of the classroom and their coaching responsibilities, if that reduction was, of course, to lead to compromising their quality in terms of a child's education and physical education. We hire teachers to deliver curriculum first. In the report, the teacher coaches reported on fatigue, not being well, not having enough time to prep. All of this impacts their teaching quality. If coaching takes away from what teachers are paid to do, then that teaching quality is compromised. This research highlights the very real demands and challenges, and it's clear that the policies that are developed must provide support to these teachers in order that they can continue to have positive impacts on the sport and coaching side, but as well as providing quality teaching and learning opportunities for all of the students in the school. Any increase in prep time for teachers resulting in reduced teaching time must be therefore backfilled by the same quality in the classroom. Meaning you wouldn't want somebody who has no passion or knowledge in sport or physical education to be coming into physical education and delivering those very important lessons to our children, just like you wouldn't want me coming into your math class and trying to deliver an algebra and geometry lesson. I would probably lose some of those children very quickly. Teachers are hired based on their specialization. Administrators in the schools recognize the importance of filling teaching roles with those most qualified to deliver quality programs in their schools. When that teacher must step away from what they're hired to do, substituting them with an unqualified replacement undermines the importance of that particular role in the school. So the question, how do we support all of this around policy and make this work? Policy development at the school board and ministry levels must support administrators in making the right choice for teachers and students to deliver and receive quality programs, making the easy choice for administrators and the right choice for students. Thanks.
Merci Martin pour la recherche. En fait, c'est des articles très intéressants à lire. Alors, j'ai lu tous tes articles sur le sujet. Et puis, ça soulève beaucoup de questions de recherche, aussi beaucoup de personnellement, parce que il y a beaucoup de gens qui étaient enseignants, entraîneurs. Moi, actuellement, depuis 8 ans, je suis professeur-entraîneur à l'UQTR. Donc, juste pour faire une courte introduction, comment je suis devenu entraîneur, professeur-entraîneur, c'est que pendant plusieurs années, il y avait un groupe d'étudiants qui voulaient faire une équipe de cross-country. Puis à chaque fois, ils allaient au service des sports et puis ils se frappaient une porte fermée. Une année, ben, je me suis un peu impatienté. Je me suis levé avec eux. On est allé au service des sports et puis ben, le directeur des sports me dit « Est-ce que tu veux entraîner, toi? » J'ai dit « Bon, peut-être, ok, c'est une bonne idée. » Donc, c'était un défi, puis c'était très intéressant. Et je me suis beaucoup reconnu en tant qu'individu, en tant qu'entraîneur dans tout ce que tu as soulevé dans tes résultats de recherche. Par contre, mon rôle ici, c'est pas tellement de témoigner de mon vécu, mais plutôt de soulever des questions de recherche qui pourraient être intéressantes. Ça soulève une tonne de questions. Le sport scolaire, on sait que c'est extrêmement important parce que c'est peut-être le plus accessible pour... en fait, si on regarde, par exemple, aux États-Unis, on voit une tonne d'équipes de ski de fond qui fournissent les équipements aux jeunes, alors qu'au Canada, ben, les jeunes, pour faire du ski de fond, c'est des clubs civils. Ils doivent payer des équipements qui sont très coûteux. Donc, in your result, competing against community sport was perceived as the lowest challenge. Do you think that it may be different if you had analyzed by separating sports? You know that individual sport coaches tend to be more possessive and controlling than in team sports. So I have personal experience for that, and I can see other colleagues, coach who live through some similar experiences. Like when you when a hockey player come to a new team, the former coach isn't going to try to control this type of a training session on don't do that, do this. You know what I mean? En Québec, en fait, au Québec, vous avez mentionné que plus d'entraîneurs contractuels interviennent, un plus grand pourcentage sont des entraîneurs qui ont été engagés, qui viennent de la communauté. En fait, c'est vrai, on le voit beaucoup. Puis un des problèmes chez ces entraîneurs-là, c'est l'abandon. Beaucoup des entraîneurs qui viennent de la communauté, il y a un gros turnover, un gros taux de renouvellement. Ils viennent 2 ans, 3 ans. C'est souvent des jeunes de 16, 17, 18, 19 ans. Et puis, ils n'ont pas beaucoup de formation. Peut-être qu'on leur, on leur paye un stage PNCE, puis niveau 1, puis bon, ils vont agir comme entraîneurs. Est-ce que vous avez vu des témoignages, vous avez entendu des témoignages de, en fait, de prof ou de, d'entraîneurs, teacher coach, qui servent de mentors à ces, à ces jeunes entraîneurs-là qui souvent n'ont pas une grosse formation? Donc ça, ça serait peut-être intéressant de voir s'il n'y aurait pas un modèle à développer en intervention ou peut-être d'explorer de ce côté-là. Ça pourrait être quelque chose de très intéressant. Also, did you find a difference in the capacity of teaching life skills between contractual coaches and teacher coaches? So if we compare to the two type of coaches, do you think there may be a difference in helping students to acquire life skills? So is it something you could find in your data or in a later study? J'aurais aimé que notre ministre soit peut-être présente pour entendre la question et peut-être la réponse. Mais est-ce que vous pensez qu'une déduction ou un crédit d'impôt pour la formation des entraîneurs de niveau scolaire, parce qu'on sait que au niveau scolaire, la ressource pour la formation continue, c'est très difficile à avoir. Est-ce que vous pensez que d'avoir un crédit d'impôt pour la formation chez les entraîneurs de niveau scolaire pourrait aider à accélérer ou à construire des équipes d'entraîneurs un peu plus... bon, est-ce que ça pourrait augmenter la motivation? Those were my questions. Another question was about PE teacher maybe not being involved more in coaching. We did some studies on health and safety in PE teachers. And one of the problems is that with their day of work, they are already tired. So at the end of the day, they already did many hours of active, and they use their whistles a lot. And it's not like me, who I coach early in the morning, 6:30, and I go back to my chair. I sit for the whole day. So that might be part of the explanation. Maybe PE teachers are not more involved because they're too tired to coach later in the day.
Okay, thank you. Martin, anything you want to react to before I open the floor to folks?
I'll just wait to
okay, let's open the floor to those of you here in the room as well as those of you joining us online. Questions for Martin Commentaire? Over to you, sir, at the back of the room. We'll get you a mic.
Hi. That on? Yeah.
And please introduce yourself again.
Peter Donnelly, University of Toronto. About 15 years ago, Mike Harris government was stepping all over Ontario, and they tried to make after-school volunteering by teachers mandatory. The teacher union's response was to withdraw all after-school labor, so all sport teams, all music, theater, debate societies, everything stopped in Ontario. And parents went ballistic. Of course, this is free labor that teachers provide, and it's become an expected part of the school for those parents and children who participate. We ran a summit at the University of Toronto, bringing all the parties together: parents, teachers, coaches, student athletes, government, everybody, teacher unions. We're all in a room together, and we set people down all day to really thrash this out. And one of the consequences was that the government withdrew any attempt to make volunteering mandatory. But there are real problems. One of the teacher coaches in the room talked about one Saturday night, a basketball coach in a London high school, I think, talked about arriving home very late from a tournament in Toronto one Saturday night. I'm walking into the bathroom very quietly, you know, after he arrived home, and finding a photograph of his wife and his kids on the toilet with a post-it saying, "Remember us." You know, so those stresses are really, really important. And one of the recommendations that we had from that was that co-curricular activities be supported in some way. And I think, you know, you saw some of that in terms of training, but the next point was relief time. And I recognize PHE Canada's concerns about this. But if co-curricular activities are important, then we need to find, you know, whether it's music or whatever, we need to find a way of supporting it. And there clearly are rich elements to it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Any other comments or questions? Yes, can we bring a mic over here, please?
Thank you, Allison Doherty, Western University. Thank you for your presentation. This question is for you, Martin, maybe for Stephanie, maybe for Peter. Where is the teacher education aspect in this? So we hear about what's going on with the teacher coaches. We hear about how Coaching Association and CCP can figure into that. Leisha said something about the expectations and that at grads will say, "Oh, I can coach." But do we know, I don't know, do any of you know, and has it been addressed, is this an area for research, about what is going on with the teacher education program? So is part of that curriculum to tell them, and what is your extracurricular area? Is it drama? Is it music? Can you lead the band? Can you stage the play? Can you coach basketball? Does anybody know anything about that? And do you want to start?
Yeah, I can take a stab at it. But so that's one of the things we've been pushing for is so what we've seen in our study, where we looked at 60% of our sample were non-PE teachers and the 40% that were. A lot of those that were PE teachers said, "Well, when I did my degree in kinesiology, I took coaching courses. And through those coaches, I was able to access like a level one NCCP or something like that. So I sort of had coach training." But for all of those that are coming, again, doing a bachelor's degree in history, you don't have access to those courses. So that's why we're pushing a lot for a teacher education when they're doing in Ontario, let's say they're 2 years now to become a teacher, that we need to have something in place related to coach education to say, well, when you're going to start your career next year, and if you're asked to coach or if you volunteer to coach, here's the minimum of qualifications or knowledge that you need to have to understand what your life is going to be as a teacher coach. But we've been pushing for that, but unfortunately we haven't gone really far.
So have you been pushing for that with the faculties of education? Like, are they a partner at this?
Well, definitely what we did is, based on the national survey, all the data was shared with the Minister of Education, and we shared everything with OSSTF, which is the teacher union, just to let them know this is what's going on. And as Professor Donnelly said, if I can just quickly, absolutely right. What we're seeing is there's a lot of fight back from the unions that they don't want to provide special treatment to those that are coaching, because it creates a lot of backlash from those that are not, saying, why are they getting preferential treatment because they're coaching and they get reduced teaching load and all that. So it goes back to that point. There's a lot of infighting related to that.
OK.
Can I come back and answer that question? Because something's just happening in Ontario around Rowan's Law and the youth concussion legislation that's just coming in Ontario. And Rowan's Law, the inquest for the death of Rowan suggested coach training for all teacher training candidates. And the College of Teachers in Ontario has just picked that up. We have no idea what it's going to look like yet or how it's going to be implemented, but the College of Teachers has advised all teacher training universities that they will have to implement coach training for all teachers.